Hear you. Are you here? Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to St. John's Open Air Holy Communion Service. If you don't know me, my name is Young. I'm privileged to be a vicar of this church. It's great to have you. It's what a privilege to have this wonderful free space where we can worship God in the open air. So it's great to have you. I hope you have had a restful, you've been having a restful weekend so far. Some of you say yes, some of you not quite. But don't worry, you are here. You are in the place where you should be this morning. You made really right choice. So, because this is the place where we're going to praise God, the living God, the Almighty God. He's going to be with us. He's going to restore us. He's going to bring His healing and empowerment as we worship Him and also listen to His word. By the way, I've been away for 3 weeks. People have been asking, how's your holiday? I said, it was too long. there's one lesson I have through my visit to Korea. The thing that I learned is this. Be thankful for what you have. I didn't expect that I would miss the British weather back in Korea. Oh gosh, it was too hot, too humid. My parents-in-law, I think my wife, she's watching the service, but my parents-in-law doesn't like, they didn't like air conditioner. So we had to somehow suffocate it, just, I miss the British weather. I just checked the British weather while I was in Korea. But anyway, be thankful, especially when it comes to worship. The psalmist says, the Bible translation. It says the Thanksgiving is the password to enter the gates of heaven, to enter into God's presence. What is the password? Thanksgiving. Give thanks to the Lord. That is the password to enter into God's presence. So, I just want to give you just one opportunity, a brief opportunity to think about what you are thankful this morning. What you are thankful. It doesn't need to be a grand story. Just one little thing that you are thankful. Just think about it. What is one thing that you are thankful to God? Or thankful to your family? Or your friend? Or your colleague? What is one thing that you are thankful? Okay, now, as usual, can you speak to the person next to you and just share it? What you are thankful. If you don't know the person next to you, you can say hello. Briefly introduce who you are. But not the lifelong story, okay? We are here to worship God, okay? So, but just share one thing that you are thankful. Okay. Well, I'm thankful that I'm here. It's great to be back. I'm thankful that I have this wonderful community, the people that I can trust, the people that I can worship God together. And Psalm 107 from verse 1 to 3 says, "Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good, for His steadfast love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom He has redeemed from the trouble and gathered in from the lands, from the east, from the west, and from the north, and from the south. The Lord has redeemed you. Whether you believe it or not, the Lord has redeemed you. It is He who gathered you here, this place." Can you hands up if you are from the east? Hands up. Well, just imagine that this is the center. Yeah? So just hands up if you are from the east. Brilliant. If you are from west, hands up. Westerfoot, yeah. From the north, brilliant. And south, it is God who brought you here. Remember that. As we worship God, remember that God has brought you here and He has redeemed you. So, if you are able, let's just stand and give thanks to the Lord for His good. His steadfast love endures forever. Amen. Thank you. Let us prepare our hearts as we pray together the prayer of preparation. You can find the prayer on your service sheets. Let's say together. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The gospel calls us to turn away from sin and be faithful to Christ. And as we offer ourselves to him, let us humbly come before God in faith, trusting in his mercy. Let's confess our sins together. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbor in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen. So Almighty God forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, and confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And a special prayer for this week, the 10th Sunday after Trinity. Let your merciful ears, O Lord, be open to the prayers of your humble servants, and that they may obtain their petitions. Make them to ask such things as shall please you, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We're going to continue to worship God. Would you like to stand?
Let me hear the call.
To the river where we can find our life. Take us to your throne room where we can meet you face to face. Take us to the mountain where we can see you and we can meet you. We can find our life and strength in you, Lord God. So take us to your river. Take us to the river. Take us there in you. To sing a song of your salvation, to win this generation for our King, a song of your forgiveness. For it is we praise that river flow, take us to the river in the city. Take us to your throne room. Give us ears to hear the cry of heaven, for they cry His mercy. Mercy to the fallen sons of man, mercy is a triumph. Triumph over judgment by your blood. Take us to the throne room. City of our God.
For the Spirit of the Sovereign God.
What you are thankful. I think this is time that we worship God. There are so many reasons that we are here to worship. As we remember, just one thing that you are thankful, let's bless the Lord.
The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes.
Bless the Lord. There is one particular line really touched me this morning. Sing like never before. I don't know, when was the last time that you are lost in worship? Please, let's make this time. Sing like never before. Lord, I will lift your name. I bless your name here. In this open air, this is a great opportunity to praise him here in this community. So I'm going to sing one more time. Bless the Lord, all my soul. The psalmist encouraged that, praise the Lord. Let everything within me praise the holy name. I think you can command to your spirit, command to your soul that praise the Lord. Let everything within me praise his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Bless the Lord. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Whatever song we sing today, this morning, we're going to sing like never before. Amen? Let's sing together one more time.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I worship your holy name.
Bless the Lord,
bless the Lord, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship your holy name. Lord, I worship your holy name. Lord, I worship your holy.
Amen. So Lord God, we give you all the glory and honor to you. This morning as we worship you, Lord God, we want to give everything because we know that you gave everything for us. Continue to speak to us, continue to touch us as we worship you in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. So, I don't know whether you are aware of our sort of summer theme. We are dealing with hot topics. Hot topics. The things that is very hot. I think the first open air service, we talked about the relationship between faith and science. Did you get it? Yeah? Was it useful? Okay. And the last week, we talk about hypocrisy, is right? I know, the week before, hypocrisy. Why there are so many hurts in the church? I'm sure you've got some answer, and I hope you're not going to hurt others any longer, right? And the last week, we had someone from Faith in Missions about why there is only one way to God. I think it's been, very rewarding to you as you join this topic. And today, we are going to listen to this theme about the Bible. Can we trust Bible? Can we trust Bible? Because some people think, you know, I was as well, actually. I thought that, you know, there seems to be so many contradictions in the Bible. So is it something that, is it worth trusting? Or no? Is the Bible still relevant in our day? But some people talk about, well, the culture is different. So the Bible is outdated. Can we trust the Bible? Yes? Okay, you've got already the answer, but I'm sure Iris will help us to understand about the Bible today. But before that, we're going to have our Bible reading. I think Darius and Jackie, they're going to do the Bible reading for us.
Good morning, St. George. The first reading is taken from the book of Psalms, 119, verses from 9 to 16. How can a young person stay on the path of purity? By living according to your word. I seek you with all my heart. Do not let me stray from your commands. I have hidden your word in my heart, that I might not sin against you. Praise be to you, Lord. Teach me your decrees. With my lips, I recount all the laws that come from your mouth. I rejoice in following your statutes, as one rejoices in great riches. I meditate on your precepts and consider your ways. I delight in your decrees. I will not neglect your word. This is the word of the Lord.
Good morning, Stratford. Good morning, Stratford Broadway, and good morning to those online. Our second reading is from Timothy chapter 3, verses 14 to 17. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it, and how from infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. All Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, and correcting and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. This is the word of the Lord.
With the high tech stuff, it's too high tech. Oh.
Is that or the Bible's too heavy? Good morning, St. John's. Good morning to those online. I was going to start with an activity for Sunday Club. I've not been on it. But there's not many of them here at the moment, so I might leave that to the end. And if there are 8 members of Sunday Club, I'll be looking for some volunteers from among you. Nothing too difficult, I promise. Right, we're there. Okay, what we're thinking about this morning is, can we trust the Bible? That's what we teach week by week, isn't it? Can we trust it? And I want to start by asking a question. And before I ask that question, I want to go back to John's Gospel, to the time when Jesus was on trial. If you'll remember from Easter, from your knowledge of the Bible, Jesus was condemned by the Jewish council because they thought he was a blasphemer, claiming to be the Son of God. But they couldn't get rid of him. They didn't have the power to put him to death, which is why he ended up in front of Pilate, the Roman governor. And Pilate had a discussion with him because it's clear that Pilate was very reluctant to condemn this man. He couldn't see any reason why he should put Jesus to death. It's a serious matter. And in their discussion, and this is from John 18, Pilate says to Jesus, "You are a king then," said Pilate. Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. In fact, the reason I was born and came into the world is to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me." "What is truth?" retorted Pilate. And that's the question I want to start with. How do we decide what is true and what isn't? How do we decide whether we can trust the Bible? Who do we believe? Do we believe what we read in the newspapers, if you still read papers? Do you believe what you hear on television? Do you believe what you come across on social media? I think many of our young people believe that to be true. But what we need to remember is that when people are putting forth what they say is true, everybody's got their own agenda. I've got my agenda this morning. I want you to trust the Bible. What's the agenda of the people who are telling you what to believe? Because they've all got one. You need to think about that. How do we decide what's true? How do we know the truth from falsehood? How do you know? I want you to take a moment to think about that, to think about how you decide what you believe and what you don't believe. Talk to the person next to you if you want to, or you can just sit and think. This is not time to have a nap, all right? Just sit and think about it. How do you decide what's true? I'm not going to ask you to tell me, so don't panic. All right. Maybe it's from experience, from what we already know. We can distinguish truth from what's not true. Maybe we take a guess and hope we're right. Depends what it's about, doesn't it? How important it is. Maybe we just test it out until we decide we've found what's true. So how do we know the Bible's true? How do we trust it? After all, it's written by 40 different people. There are 66 books. Some of them wrote more than one, as we know, like Paul and Luke and others. Can we trust it? It may be that we decide we trust some of it. Some of it we like. So we're all in favor of that. Whether that's the life of Jesus or the Psalms, lots of people like reading the Psalms. Whether perhaps it's the Beatitudes. Whether it's Revelation with its hope of Jesus coming back and a new kingdom. Some bits we like and some we find offensive. We don't like them because they don't chime with what we believe. And we reject those bits of the Bible. But if one part's true, doesn't that mean all of it's true? I think so. I want to suggest that there are three reasons why we can trust the Bible. And you may know others. Come and tell me afterwards, please, and I'll expand my knowledge. The first one, I think, and perhaps the most important one, is that the Bible's teaching about God is consistent from Genesis to Revelation. It's a slow revelation of what God is like. This is Almighty God we're talking about. We can't take it all in at once. There's a slow revelation of what God is like from Genesis 1, where he's the creator. Genesis 1 tells us that our world is in God's hands. Every world, the universe, is in God's hands. And it also tells us that God is three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, all there at creation. God doesn't suddenly become a Trinity in the New Testament. It's there right through the Bible. And as we read through our Old Testament, we learn more and more of what God's like because we see him loving Adam and Eve in the garden, even though he knows they're going to get it wrong. We see him calling his people to be his people, Israel, leading them out of slavery in Egypt, providing for them as he leads them through the wilderness, loving them, showing them how to be his people, protecting them, providing for them. When they get to Canaan, he's there helping them to clear the land so they can take it over because this is the promised land. He's there with David as he has to drive away the Philistines who want the land back, of course. God, the one who loves people, the God who wants to be in relationship with people. That's what it's all about. The covenant, the law. I will be your God and you will be my people. It's a covenant of love, not just law. It's based on God's love. But the Bible tells us this is unfailing love for each one of us. He's a God who wants to bless us. Do you believe that? Yeah, good, because it's true. In the Old Testament, there's these indications that while the old covenant is with his people, there's going to be a new covenant which is going to include all of us. And there's going to be a Messiah, the anointed one, who will come. And of course, when we get to the New Testament, we discover that Jesus is not just the Messiah, but he is God in human form. He's the Son of God, come to live among us. Jesus, who himself is the Word of God, John tells us. Jesus, who brings us good news, the best news, that we can know God for ourselves, that we can be saved, that we can have a place in heaven if we trust him. And a God who comes to make that sacrifice for our sin, Under the first covenant, it was the animals. I always feel a bit sorry for all these animals, but it was their blood that was offered as sacrifice for the people's sin. In the New Testament, it's no longer the animals, it's God's Son who is the sacrifice. It's his blood who is shed for our sins once and for all. Doesn't have to keep doing it. The one perfect sacrifice that we might be God's people. And we see Jesus, the Son of God, humbling himself, taking on the shame, dying alongside the criminals for us. And again, it's God's unfailing love which brings us this new life. The Bible, I believe, tells us the truth about ourselves, that we're in need of salvation. It tells us the truth about God so we can trust it. And if you think about it, if the Bible tells us that we're sinful people, doesn't that make sense of the world we live in, that it's in such a mess? You think back into the history of all the wars that have happened, all the relationships that are broken, all the suffering that there's been, because we live in a sinful world and we're sinful people, and that's what the Bible tells us. Of course, we can accept the Bible, we can accept salvation, or we can reject it. It's our choice, because God doesn't force us. That's the first reason, the consistency of the teaching. The second reason for me is that Jesus accepted it as the word of God. He quoted from the Old Testament. Remember the time they were in the, he was in the wilderness, and Satan wanted to stop him from obeying his Father's will, coming and preaching the kingdom. And how did Jesus overcome him? He used the Bible. He quoted from the Bible. If we are being tempted, the Bible is our weapon. It's the sword of the Spirit, says Paul. If we quote the Bible at the temple, at the devil, sorry, he will flee. He will flee because God's word is so powerful. And of course, Paul accepted the Old Testament as the word of God. Remember, Paul was a Pharisee, one of this sect in New Testament times and Old Testament, who knew their Old Testament back to front. I'm sure if you asked Paul, he would have quoted you the chapter and verse, because he had studied it. He'd studied the Old Testament. He studied all the what the rabbis have said about how to interpret it. He knew his Old Testament. And because of that, he rejected Jesus. He said, no. Our law is the right religion. God is the God of the first of the covenant. Jesus, I don't know who he is, but I don't believe in him. And of course, all that changed when Jesus met with him. That's how most of us come to know Jesus, isn't it? Because we become aware of his presence. The Holy Spirit applies that word to our heart, and we realize that he really is Lord and Savior. And so Paul changed. And he saw, once he came to know Jesus, he saw, oh, the Old Testament was fulfilled in all that Jesus was and all that he did. And in this letter to Timothy, it's his second letter to Timothy. Timothy was a young man who was leading the church in Ephesus, so he had a really important job to do. And Paul was in prison, not for the first time, in prison in Rome. Nero was the emperor. If you know anything about Nero, you know what a cruel and possibly madman he was. And Paul felt that his time was short. So he wanted to write to Timothy because he wanted to encourage Timothy to keep going. When we look at the church, the early church, when we come to Pentecost, we see the Spirit coming. We see Peter preaching. We see the church being born, the meeting together, and it all looks great. But let's remember that this was all going on in the Roman Empire, which was pagan from beginning to end. Or maybe not at the end, eventually they came to believe. But it was pagan. Every street you went round would have a shrine to a different god. There's so many gods and goddesses. So it wasn't easy for the church. Don't let's think it was easy in the time of Acts. It wasn't easy in Ephesus, where Timothy was. And Paul wanted him to help the church just to persevere, not to give up. In the earlier part of this chapter, which we didn't read, he was saying to Timothy that actually, however tough it is now, it's going to get worse. All right, people are going to reject. There is going to be suffering. We know that some of the Christians, the early leaders, were put to death, like Stephen and James, and that would continue. But Paul wanted Timothy and the church. It's all right, just a minute. I don't know how to alter this, but it's made itself go up, so I'm standing a bit back. What's wrong with it? Thank you. We'll take a different stand next time. Paul wanted Timothy and the church to remember Scripture, to be based in Scripture, to have it in their hearts, because that's where they find the strength to keep going. That's where we found our strength, if we know God's word, to keep going, to keep persevering. And what does Paul say about Scripture? Perhaps the most important thing he says is that it is inspired by God. It may have been 40 different writers at different times, different civilizations, different cultures, but God was there leading them to write it down, and they wrote it down for us. That's why we need to read it and trust it. It's inspired. It teaches us how to be Jesus people. It stops us if we're getting it wrong. You ever had that experience? You read something and you think, maybe I shouldn't be doing that. Maybe I shouldn't be thinking that. Lord, help me to change. So it's there to help us. It's help us to grow as Jesus' disciples, because it's great. We get converted. We come to know Jesus. But it doesn't stop there. We need to grow. We need to get to know him better. We need to get to know his word and to love his word and to learn better how to be his people. Do we come to him willing to be changed, or are we happy as we are? Jesus wants to mold us, to make us more like him, because that way his life and his light can be reflected to those around us. Do you have a favourite handbook? I have a pile of cookery books in my cupboard, which I go to all the time. They're my handbook, if you like. Nick has various handbooks for different styles of car, because he loves cars, as you might know. The Bible is our handbook. We can't manage without it. We won't grow without it. We need to trust it. We need to see it as God's word to each one of us. And the psalmist, what was the psalmist saying? He said that God's word was central to his life. I seek you with all my heart. You know, as we read, we are seeking God's presence. We're seeking his leading. We're seeking for him to apply that word to our lives. I've hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. There it is again. Knowing the word helps us to walk and not give in to temptation. He rejoices. He delights. Because the word helps him to know how to obey Jesus. And when we obey, there is joy. Jesus is the one who gives us joy. Joy in knowing him. Joy in learning more about him. Joy in walking with him. But we need the word. So we have to decide, can we trust the Bible? Is it true? Is it from the Lord? The Bible claims it is the inspired word of God. We have to decide. And in our world, as we know, everything changes. What's going on at the moment wasn't going on 12 months ago. And in 12 months' time, things will have changed again. Who knows? But God's word doesn't change. It doesn't change to fit in with what society says is right. God's word stands as his truth. And if society doesn't like it, well, that's up to them, isn't it? Our society's gone a long way from God's truth. What doesn't change is his word and his unfailing love. You know, we're all precious to him. Do you know that? That you're precious to him. He watches over you. He's always with you if you trust him. He will never leave you. That's his promise. And as we trust him, as he trusts his word, we find that that light and that life which comes from Jesus. Remember, that's what John says, that he brought light and life into the world. We need light because we live in so much darkness. If we reject him, if we reject Jesus and we reject the Bible as true, never mind that there are certain contradictions. I think we won't understand those till we get to heaven. And I don't think it matters, really. We need to trust it. But if we reject it, then we are left in the confusion of the world. We're left in the darkness. We're left never knowing what's true and what isn't, except what we think. And we're left never knowing how much we're treasured by Jesus. But accepting it and trusting it isn't enough, is it? You know I was going to say this. We need to read it. It's no good saying, oh, there it is on the shelf, I trust it. We need to be reading it. And we need to be reading it expectantly, asking the Holy Spirit to help us understand it, because that's what he wants to do. I'm going to finish with a verse I had no intention of telling you, but somehow it kept coming up this week, so I think that's a hint that I should share it. It's from one of the minor prophets called Zephaniah, and his work was to tell Judah that judgment was coming because they had rejected the Lord. But right at the end, and he says, but the Lord will restore you. Listen to this wonderful verse. It's Zephaniah 3:17. The Lord your God is with you, the mighty warrior who saves. He will take great delight in you. In his love, he will no longer rebuke you. He will rejoice over you with singing. Imagine that. God singing over us, that's what it says. So let's rejoice that the Bible is our handbook, that Jesus is Saviour for all who will believe. And let's delight in his love and his presence. Amen? Amen. Right, have we got any Sunday club? In that case, if you would like to come forward, all I need you to do is hold a bit of paper up, okay? I can see some of you there. I need 8 people. One, thank you. Oh, good brother. Right, let's put that under there so it doesn't blow away, we hope. Okay. One more. I'm going to choose an adult, right? Okay, come on then. That saved all of you, didn't it? All right, what I'd like you to do is hold it up. Hold it up so that they can see it. Okay, and I need all of you to help them to put it in the right order. All right? It's a very well-known verse. I'm not telling you where it's found, really. All right, which word comes first? Anybody?
My.
Not quite.
My. My part of life.
Which word comes first? It's from the psalm, of course. Your, yes. So can your come at the end, please? That's it. Read it this way. What comes next, do you think?
Light.
No. Word. Yes. Your word. Joseph, you're next. Is. Right. That's in the right place.
Yes.
There's a word missing. It should be R here somewhere, and there isn't. So we'll imagine that. A light. Have we got it? Your word is a light on my path. Psalm 119, verse 105. Make that your verse for the week. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Iris. Yes, well, if we trust the Bible, as she says, it requires action, yes? When you trust something, no. When I trust the chair, I sit. If I don't sit, because, well, I don't trust, well, you know. when we trust the Bible, it requires action, response. The first thing is, you may spend more time to read the Bible. If you trust that the Bible is God's word, the truth, you know, who's going to somehow avoid to read Bible, you know? And, of course, second action will be just obey the truth. There are many ways that you can read the Bible, you know, with fun, be more creative way. There's really good app, YouVersion. I don't know if you've downloaded. Has anyone has got that Bible app in your phone? That's quite good. It gives you different sort of sessions and themes, so you can just follow it. Archbishop of Canterbury, he reads Psalm every day. And so there is, you can subscribe that one, and you will receive the email each day. So it's like a month cycle. So you just read three or four psalms every day for a month, and you finish the whole psalm every month. But you know, Archbishop of Canterbury, he read psalm. He finished psalm every month. That's really great, fascinating one. Bible 1 year app, or you can subscribe it. It's HTB Holy Trinity Brompton. They send you the scripture to read each day, and also with some short reflection. It's really, really fascinating. So many interesting stories and inspirations. So there's so many ways that you can read the Bible in a more creative way, with fun and excitement. So please join with me. Let's read the Bible and obey. Now Chuk is going to lead us to pray.
Welcome everyone. It's time to pray. If you look at verse of the day today, it says, as a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. And at the beginning of the service today, Reverend Young asked, what are you thankful for? So we have many reasons to be thankful today. One of my reasons, that we are here worshiping God. You know, it's a great family to be a part of. Okay, I can see everyone. And that which also gives me joy to be part of the family. And another reason I'm thankful today is, I called Darius on Sunday last week to come and help me out in my shop in Stratford. Without any hesitation, Darius stepped in and kept my shop running throughout this week. And what he was doing was improving daily, every day, in fact, day by day. That gave me a lot of reasons also to be thankful. Okay, let us pray. Let's start with giving thanks to God for being here. Okay, dear Heavenly Father, we thank you because we are here worshiping you, because we are alive today, because you have sustained us to be here. Father, we are grateful. We say glory be to your holy name, in the name of Jesus. And also we give thanks to those who have recovered from illness. Okay, and we give thanks for those who have been able to find work. But we give thanks for the year 2023 in faith. Now, before we go on, we also want to give thanks to God for bringing Reverend Young back to us safely. Father, we are grateful. May your name be glorified in the name of Jesus. Now, there's one thing I want to tell you about today's prayer. Our God is a story changer. Okay? And as the psalmist says, he said that he will, as a father has compassion on his children, God will have compassion. Okay? If you want to pray this prayer, if you want your story to change, okay, we want one thing or the other to change in our life. Okay? It could be work, it could be our children, it could be our business, our finance, it could be anything. could be our relationship. We want it to change. Okay? If you don't want something to change, don't pray, because if you pray, something will change. Okay? That's the key to it. We are going to say, our mighty warrior, the story changer, change my story today. Okay? You don't need to tell me your story. You are telling to God, my mighty warrior, change my story today. Okay, your story could be your relationship with your children, with your parents. Okay? We say it, my mighty warrior, change my story today. Change the story of everyone who are sick or who is sick here. I have a list. I have Emma's mom, Paul, Janice, Margaret. I have Hyacinth, Christopher, Kevin, Helen, Jim, Jackie's sister, Millie's brother, Archdeacon Ewins, and all those who are unwell. Our mighty warrior, story changer, change the story of these our brethren, of these our family members, of this congregation, our friends, our neighbors. Story changer, my mighty warrior, change their story today in the name of Jesus. Father, we bring to you those who are bereaved, for Sylvia, for Yvonne, Blessing, Radcliffe, Millie, Dennis, Kay. Father, our mighty warrior, change their story today. Bring peace and comfort to them in the mighty name of Jesus. We bring our Reverend Young family, even as they are in Korea, Father, story changer, change their story wherever they are. Bless them and keep them in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we bring everyone in this congregation into your care, into your throne, at the foot of the cross. Story changer, change our story today. Those looking for work, Father, change their story. Those looking for financial improvement, enhancement, Father, change their story. Those looking for business, change their story. Those looking for wives, Father, change their story. Those looking for husbands, Father, change their story. Whatever you are looking for today. Those looking for healing, Father, at the foot of the cross, there is healing. My mighty warrior, the story changer, change their stories. In the mighty name of Jesus, St. John, Father, change our story. In Stratford, change our story. In London, Father, in United Kingdom, change our story. In Nigeria, Father, my God, change our story. In Ukraine, Father, change their story today. And every part of the world, my mighty warrior, change our story. In the mighty name of Jesus, as we move into a new week, Father, my God, from Monday to Saturday, even to Sunday, Father, my God, change our stories daily. Sustain us by your power. Uphold us in your mighty hand. Father, my God, we will go out and come back in peace. In the mighty name of Jesus, at the end of next week, Father, my God, we have evidence that you have changed our story. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen.
Thanks, Chuck. It's really powerful prayer. Would you like to stand for our offering? You know, our ministry is run by your generous giving. So let's offer all we have and all we are to God cheerfully as God blesses us generously. And during the offertory hymn, we're going to pass the offering plates. But if you are here as a guest, don't worry. You can just let the plates just pass by you. But if you want to make any donation, feel free to make it. We are so grateful. Also, we have I've forgotten to card machine in the church, and it must be in the office. But anyway, so we are grateful for your generous giving. And as we give what we have, let's sing together, Immortal and Invisible. Oh, flesh and no strength.
victorious, thy great name we praise. On resting, on hasty, and silent as light, no wanting, no wasting, thou rulest in might. Thy justice like mountains high soaring above, thy clouds reach up fountains of goodness and love. To all life thou givest, to both big and small, in all life thou livest, the true life of all. We blossom and flourish as leaves on the tree, and wither and perish, but not change as thee. Great Father of glory, your Father of light, thy angels adore thee for veiling their sight. O Lord, we would render, O help us to see, it's only the splendor of light given thee.
Gracious God, we just give you praise for all you've done, all the things that you have given to us. So Father, in response to your love and care, Lord God, we give what we have. Our time, our energy, our prayer, our finance, our life to you. And as we, Lord God, trust in you, bless us as we walk with you, Lord God. We pray that you would bless this giving, these offerings, and use this for your kingdom, for your mission. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So Jesus said, love one another. As I have loved you, so you are to love one another. The peace of the Lord be always with you. So let us offer one another a sign of peace. We have an open space. Just feel free to just walk around. If you meet someone, you haven't seen the person for a long time, just walk around, say hello, and peace be with you. Just pass God's peace to the person behind you, next to you, in front of you, across the row or the chair. Just say, peace be with you, everyone. Please be seated. Thank you. And let's celebrate the Lord's Supper together. as you pray this prayer, the communion prayer, you can find on the service sheet. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love, you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ, you shared our life, that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. And on the night he was betrayed at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. And at the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, and he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all. And as we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising glory, send your Holy Spirit, that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord. So with your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. As our Savior taught us, we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. So draw near with faith, receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. I would like to invite our communion assistant to the front, please. And also worship team.
Got that.
So you can send it to this
to know the saying of the Lord. Peace, Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I fool Him, oh, I know. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him all.
Please, for those that need prayers, please, can you move to the prayer zone?
Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust His cleansing blood, just His simple faith to hungry death of healing cleansing blood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trusted, how I stood Him on earth. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him all. Yes, 'tis sweet to trust in Jesus, just from sin and self to sin, just from Jesus simply taking life and rest and joy and peace. How I trust Him, how I thought Him all adore. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him all.
So during the communion, our prayer ministry team will offer you prayer. So if you want to receive prayer, please come to the prayer zone. Just over there, and our team will offer you prayer.
I'm so glad I learned to trust Him, precious Jesus, Savior, friend. And I know that He is with me, will be with me too. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I trust Him, oh, adore. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him all. So sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take Him at His word, just to rest upon His promise, and to know the saying of the Lord. Jesus, Jesus.
To God by praying the prayer of the communion together. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and walk to your praise and glory. Amen. Our service is nearly coming to an end. I've got some notices for you. Just once again, welcome everyone. Is there anyone who are new to this church, this gathering today? Can you raise your hands? Yeah, and you're not new. But you may feel new, that's great. And you're new here, so welcome, welcome. Anyone else? Yeah, welcome. And there as well. Let's give them a big round of applause. If you want to know more about the church or more Christianity, if you are new to this Christianity, please speak to me or our church wardens at the back. Corinne is there, Breeze is at the back, and Reverend Nick is there as well. So please speak to us. We'll let you know about the church. I want you to be part of this family. That would be amazing. After the service, do we have refreshment? Yes, yes, oh, great. So please don't leave straight away after the service. Please stay around for the refreshments. And introduce yourself and have some catch up with one another. That would be great. This Tuesday, we have a very special event. Our annual event, our Healing Cafe annual event. So once a year, we have outdoor special service. There will be so many things going on. So we're going to have a bouncy castle, nail art? Nail painting. All right. Can I have one? Just pinky, that would be great. Yes, so, but you're more than welcome to join it. So it starts from 11 o'clock. However, we need some setting up this area. So if you can come early, like 10 o'clock or 10:30, and then we can set up this area and to welcome those people and for the community. So Healing Cafe, outdoor service this coming Tuesday. That would be great. And next week, that's right, are you? Next week, there will be Nigerian gathering to talk about Nigerian Day, to discuss about the Nigerian Day. So if you are from Nigeria, do you have some kind of committee or anyone who is part of this meeting? Okay, so if you are part of this Nigerian Day, I don't know whether you call it committee, but you know who are.
Hello everyone, it's actually for the Nigerian group, so we're going to meet in the Christchurch room next week at the end of the service, just for a brief meeting to update you on what's happening as we're having our Nigerian Day on the 1st of October this year. So it's going to be a wonderful celebration and we want to involve everyone, so please we expect you to wait, we'll stay behind next week. So I'm just giving you like a week's notice so that next week when you're coming along, you know that you have to wait a bit after the service. Thank you. Yes. I was supposed to bring the scarves today, but when I was rushed out and I forgot the scarf. But I'll definitely bring them next week so that you'll be able to have your Nigerian scarves as well. Thank you.
Awesome. Birthdays to celebrate this week. I'm going to read the names here on the list. So if you're here in this place, can you stand up? And also if you're children, I've got your card. But the card is not in the envelope, so I'm going to just read these names. Okay. So, oh gosh, so many cards here. All right. Let me just read these names. So these are the people who's got birthday this week. So it's wonderful. So Peace, Onuka, Esme Reynolds McLean, Daniela Mandela, Ari Ogundare, Whitney Joseph, Maya Akinsola, Trey Valentine. Oh, a piece! America. Happy birthday! You're gonna be four! You need to find your card. Oh, this is a piece. Well, it's not in the, you know. Happy birthday. Daniela, okay, great. Guys, Daniela Mandela. Is she the one who swims? Is she the... She's a good swimmer, yeah? Okay, great. Oh, happy birthday, Daniela. Okay. The peace birthday is today. Okay, so when we sing a birthday song, you have to come forward, right? Okay, is it Amy Mabirizi? Mabirizi? Amy Mabirizi? Kenneta Ahana? Abby Eric Igoni? Amber Bizimugu? Unique West Alashi? Bumi? Yeah, he's serving the... his birthday this week, for me, Opede Dare. And Mercy Okunoren. Is Mercy? Okay. Mercy is there as well. Okay, two members are there. And Taya Ogonsola. Taya Ogonsola. Yeah. Okay, so, peace, come on, come here. So today is Peace's 4th birthday, and Spomi is here, and Mercy's there.
Happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you, may the Lord bless and keep you. Happy birthday to you.
Hip hip! Hooray! Hooray. Hip hip! Hooray! Well done. Rose, your birthday too as well. Sorry. Oh,
happy birthday.
We have one more. Sorry, there is Rose on another paper. Sorry, Rose. Let's sing one more time. Happy birthday. 1, 2, 3.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. May the Lord bless and keep you. Happy birthday to you.
Sorry, I missed it. Okay, our service is now really coming to an end, so we got now final hymn to sing. Oh Lord my God, as we continue to read God's word, be led by His word and spirit, I think you will find something new this week. Something that God is going to do, something new for you in your life, pressing your relationship, in your circumstances. Let's just trust in God that He is good and faithful God, faithful Father for all of us. Would you like to stand and sing together? O Lord, my God. Blessing on the book of Numbers. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you now and always. Amen. So brothers and sisters, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.
Amen.